Good evening, everybody, and welcome to another MHPN interdisciplinary panel discussion. And this time it's the third in our series of complex trauma, which has been supported by some funding from the Royal Commission into Childhood Sexual Abuse. And this is in partnership with ASCA, the Adult Surviving Childhood Abuse Organisation, and I highly recommend their website if you haven't had a chance to look at it already. Now, we've had a record number of participants register for this webinar. Currently, we have 650 of you online, and there have been 2,900 people have expressed an interest in this one and registered. So that's very exciting for MHPN, and I'm sure it indicates how important this topic is to everybody. So I just introduce myself. My name's Mary Amelius. I'm a general practitioner and psychotherapist. I work at Headspace in Cairns. It is cold in Cairns. It reached below 20 degrees last night and we had to turn off the fans and close the windows. And I know that we've got participants from all around Australia. And so I'd like to just let you know that the panellists that we have on tonight, their biographies were distributed before the webinar, and you may have had a chance to look at that, but I'll briefly just remind everybody of who we've got, and we're really excited to have such experienced people tonight. I think my visuals are slightly slower than my conversation, so sorry if I'm a bit stilted this evening. So I'd firstly like to welcome Bradley Fox-Lewin, who's the consumer advocate on our panel tonight. Now, Bradley, you're really here on the panel to represent the voice of the consumer, and I wondered if you'd just like to just give us a very brief summary about the kind of work that you do in this area, as well as having a background yourself as a survivor.
Oh, hi, Mary. It's great to be here, and thank you for that welcome. Look, my role, yes, is to be a consumer advocate in this situation. I am also a practicing counsellor and have had some experience in psychotherapy, but I'm really glad to be bringing the consumer perspective. I currently work in a number of roles which have me identify first as a consumer and survivor, and I bring that kind of lived experience to this situation from in training settings and also through the New South Wales Mental Health Commission in my role there as Deputy Commissioner. And I really believe that we need to get across the space of supporting the expertise of consumers and survivors to be central to the work that we do. And without taking away the fantastic expertise there are amongst people who are there to support.
Thanks very much, Bradley, and welcome. And I'd like also to welcome Sarah Kokona. So Sarah's a mental health nurse on our panel this evening, and mental health nurses work across the discipline in mental health, all sorts of different settings. So, Sarah, I just wondered how you developed an interest in working with complex trauma.
Hi, Mary. Thanks. And, yeah, great to be on the panel with everybody tonight. Most of my experience has been in the public adult health sector, mostly in the community, but also inpatient, and also working as a mental health nurse in the homeless health sector. And I developed an interest in trauma-informed care because the vast majority of the people that I work with are survivors of complex trauma, and I instantly resonated with the principles of trauma-informed care. And when I was first exposed to the literature, I was so happy. It made so much sense to me and recontextualized the way that I could think about working with consumers. And, yeah, I just think really passionate about trauma care, and I'm involved in trying to introduce those kinds of changes in public mental health settings.
Thanks very much, Sarah, and welcome. And I'd like to welcome Philip Hilda. Now, Philip's the psychologist on our panel this evening. And Philip, I noticed in your biography that you are a practitioner in something called HACOMI. Could you just give us a, if it's possible, 10-word introduction to what that is?
HACOMI is a synthesis of Western psychotherapy and Eastern philosophy, really, Buddhist and Taoist sort of philosophy. A group of psychotherapists in the USA came together in 1980 and to start an institute that was having principles of mindfulness in psychotherapy and non-violence in psychotherapy, working holistically in psychotherapy and really trusting the client and trusting the implicit processes of the client. And Akomi sort of is a name that was borrowed to fit that work. And the meaning of Akomi is, you know, how are you in relationship to whatever, you know, to these many realms, to yourself, to your partner, to your work, to your history. It asks the question, how are you in relationship? So it's introspective, but it's not solely, you know, interpretive. It's quite holistic and relational and very mindful psychotherapy. And I fell in love with it when I first found it in the early 90s. And so I went and studied it as well as, you know, mainstream psychology, and have been blending the two ever since.
Thanks very much, Philip. And it's great to have, all of our panelists have a really broad experience. And I guess that's one of the things I've been learning about trauma, is that it has to be a holistic approach, and holistic in the term of the team that looks after someone as well, including the person themselves. So I think it's a really, really interesting panel tonight. And last but certainly not least, I'd like to welcome Warwick Middleton, who's the psychiatrist on our panel. He's an adjunct professor. And Warwick, you've got a very long experience in the field of trauma, and particularly in an interest in dissociation and involvement with the Belmont Hospital in Brisbane and a number of other activities. And I wonder if you could just briefly say what it was that made you interested in trauma. I'm imagining that may not have been an emphasis of your psychiatric training, that something's taken you down that path.
Yeah. Yes, it wasn't emphasised when I trained. I take the view that complex trauma is mainstream psychiatry, and it's actually been very interesting and quite heartening the way in which you know, the general health community and the mental health community in particular, you know, over the last two decades in Australia has actually progressively recognised that. And the sort of audience that you're getting for this webinar reflects that sort of interest, which we've seen across the board in conferences, seminars, publications. And when you look at sort of membership of international societies that work in this area, they've never been higher in Australia than they are now.
Thanks very much, and I guess that's really heartening to hear that. So you've also heard the case study before the webinar, and some of you, this might be the second or third in this series, so you're familiar with our person, Tanya. Just some technical matters. Put your general questions into the chat box. So the panellists will more or less keep in on top of that, and I will try to as well. You did submit some questions at registration, and we will try to pick up those themes throughout the webinar. I apologise if your specific question doesn't get answered, but there are now 743 participants online, so it's going to be really hard to address everybody's questions at the same time. So just remember that when you're in the chat box, certainly people are welcome to talk to each other. Just remember it's a public space and 700 people can read what you're writing. Your feedback's really important. So at the end of the webinar, please fill out the exit survey. You will receive some CPD points in the weeks following. That'll be emailed to you. And MHPM certainly does take your feedback seriously. So if you have any comments about other area topics of interest or things that you'd like to be carried on further, please feel welcome to put that into your exit survey. Now, there's some learning outcomes. So we're going to hopefully, through an interdisciplinary panel discussion about this case, understand the key principles along with the role and approach of the different disciplines in working therapeutically with someone who has experienced or been exposed to childhood abuse, to be able to identify interventions, approaches and strategies which promote positive outcomes for people who have experienced or been exposed to childhood abuse, and to take home tips for interdisciplinary collaboration to work therapeutically with people who've been exposed to or experienced childhood abuse. And I think that's one of the key messages I've been getting, is it's virtually impossible for one clinician to do this work alone, and it needs to be a team. And I think that's why the MHPN format is just so important, to build those networks. So I think that that's probably enough. Just a reminder about Tanya, who in our previous webinar she met, she's a single mum of two young girls, teenagers. She's been through a lot of things in her life, and at this stage she's kind of engaged with a therapist that she's seeing on an ongoing basis. So what was in the case study was about some of the things that have been happening in that therapy. Now, some of those things might have been a bit confronting or a bit unusual, but for those people who work regularly in this field, most of it is kind of what we're used to. But nevertheless, these things are, you know, can often be surprising and difficult to handle. So I'm sure we're going to cover lots of interesting material tonight. So I'd like to first of all welcome our panelist, who is our consumer advocate, Bradley. So Bradley, when you read the case study about Tanya's therapy and what's happening in there, I wonder how you would think about Tanya. So thanks very much and welcome, Bradley.
Thank you. Look, when I read the scenario, I really thought, here's somebody who's seeking engagement and seeking relationship with another, with a number of people, and wondering, you know, how could Tanya be supported to actually follow up with that seeking in kind of safe ways, where she might not have actually had that opportunity in the past to be able to engage in a situation where she's held and feels safe. And some of the kind of approaches that she took to engage and kind of get connection with people might not seem appropriate in the first part, but given the context that one could imagine that she's coming from, it seems entirely understandable and kind of contextually correct, really, for her experience to be engaging in the ways that she's engaging. So it didn't hold a whole lot of surprises for me, but it did lead me to kind of think, here's somebody doing the best with what they have, and how can we support her to develop those skills further. And leads me to that, the slide that's up on the slideshow, whatever you call it. And it's a little slide that I just really love. It hangs on my curtain in my office, and when I kind of get kind of maybe a little bit possibly overwhelmed myself by the process of identifying as a consumer and a survivor in this in the sector, I go back to this, and it says, when somebody loves you, the way they say your name is different. You just know that it's safe in their mouth. And it's a quote from a little boy named Billy. I don't know where it comes from, but it's just a something that I hold dear. I hold as dear as when somebody approaches a professional or approaches any other human being, if their name is held as safe in that person's mouth, then we know we're in the right place to actually be together in a useful way. So shall I continue with the slides? And
Bradley. Now, just one technical thing. I actually didn't explain. Many of the participants will be familiar with it, but each presenter is going to present their first response to the case before we commence the interdisciplinary discussion. So, Bradley, if you could carry on with that, and if you're happy to advance your own slides, that'd be great. Thank you.
No problem. Yeah, I just wonder if people can hold this idea of somebody's name being safe in your mouth. I think it's just a wonderful kind of concept, and to come out of a four-year-old's mouth just gives it even more of a poignant kind of, lands with me in a particular way. But for professionals, and a lot of this is not me drawing on my own professional work. It's in many ways drawing on what's actually helped me to recover from significant childhood trauma, or at least be in recovery. And what I, in response to the scenario, I would be asking people to be willing to really engage in diverse ways of knowing that create, that, you know, people creatively adapt to their situation and maybe don't always have the skills to do it in a way that actually may seem like, you know, down in the middle ground. Sometimes it's quite edgy, the way that people try and engage in relationships. And I see Tanya doing that. And it doesn't mean that it's wrong. It just means that this is a way that a person has adapted to be able to try to kind of regulate their own experience. And I've had those experiences of trying to regulate in unusual ways. And that means that people who are in the helping trades actually need to be able to kind of recognise that some of these approaches will be unusual and that that's not wrong. It's just a way that people learn how to cope. And I just really like this quote by Steve Onken. He says that children make adaptations to survive that are brilliant and creative, but they're often personally costly. And that, you know, I've also done that myself, engaged in some behaviours around drugs and alcohol that haven't actually worked for me long term. But while that was the thing that I could do, that was the thing I did, because it actually supported me to deal with the level of pain that I was experiencing, and allowed me, you know, they don't call smoking pot getting out of it for no reason. There's a reason for calling it getting out of it, is because there's reason to seek to get away from that sort of internal pain and the experience of running up against possibly people who aren't going to understand you. So I really like this. Contact is the thing that I see as the first port of call. It's people who have been able to contact me and hold me in a particular way that kind of supported me to come back into relationship in the very small sense in the first part, that enabled me to go to a place of, okay, you know, I might feel safe enough to connect with this person. And actually that contact over time actually has supported me to make connections with a person that would then build into relationship. And over time that would lead me to, has led me to a place of being able to manage and hold intimate relationships and a sense of place, of being in the world. And as a result of getting a sense of place in the world, being able to kind of like reshape my own sense of self. And that's what I see Tanya doing as well, is she's kind of like seeking connection. She's seeking kind of contact on a number of different levels. And if those smaller kind of processes are held well, then everything else becomes possible. And that's why I kind of put that up there as a slide, because I don't, and sometimes services actually go for relationship. We need to create relationship with people. And that's all good and fine in how it's kind of put out there in language, but the building blocks of relationship are around contact. And sometimes people are overwhelmed by that whole idea of, here's somebody trying to help me and be in relationship with me, and that's just really too scary. And so I'm going to exit out that door in order to create the isolation that actually allows me to manage my dysregulation, my internal dysregulation, and escape that relationship, because it's too fast, too quick, too overwhelming.
Brad, so I'm going to interrupt you for just a moment, because I've seen your slides and I know that they're fabulous, and we have a limited time to get through each person. So I was wondering if you would mind just going over them at a more superficial level, and then I promise I'll give you the opportunity to get more into depth in the panel discussion.
No problem.
I hope you don't find me rude, but there's really good stuff in there and I want to make sure we get through it all.
Not rude at all. I put my lion up here because people who are survivors often experience kind of like feeling like prey animals in regard to service delivery and people trying to support them. I think it's absolutely imperative to support people to have an expert position in their own recovery, and that authority actually gets in the way, whereas co-authoring actually is very supportive of people and helping along the way. And we'll talk about Vygotsky later. and the person who's able to apologise is a person who evokes kind of trust. Somebody who's able to apologise, and I've had this in my past, where people have said, look, I'm really sorry, something has disrupted our relationship, and I'm sorry if I've had anything to do with that. It may not be to do with me, it may be to do with what's going on between us, but I apologise for any part that I've had in it. It has been an amazing shift in the relational quality and how I've been able to be supported, and I think Tanya would benefit from that too. Yeah, let's talk about some of these other things later on, so we can move on.
Okay.
Only to say, I think this is a lovely one. Don't be afraid to open the can of worms. The person's already living with them. It's people don't have to be afeared of opening the can of worms. People are walking around with their can of worms. Mm-hmm. And if we can engage that can of worms in a useful way, there's a future. Yeah, and there's a last point around hope and despair. Hope is for the relational kind of realm. Despair is for supervision, is what I'd like to say.
I particularly like that one, Bradley. I knew it was coming up. thanks so much for that. And now I'd like to welcome Sarah to respond from the mental health nurse perspective as to how you would be if you saw Tanya. Thanks very much. I'll go on to your first slide. I think my video is a little slower than the audio. I'll let you do the slides now. Thank you.
I've put it onto my first slide. Thanks, Mary. So I'm aware that the participants in the webinar tonight have read the case study and are familiar with Tanya's history. And I just want to highlight how important it is to hold Tanya's experiences in mind. I think it's one of the most important trauma-informed approaches that we as clinicians can take, is to respectfully, seriously ask, what has happened to this person? This is just as essential to keep in mind with long-term clients as well as people with whom we work with short-term. This inquiring humanistic stance helps to contextualise Tanya's presentation as one of resilience in the face of gross injustice, a constant sense of danger, a lack of security and support, overwhelming pain and stress. And to my mind, this framework is so much more useful and therapeutic than asking what's wrong with this person and then jumping straight into treating the problems and managing the risks. We know that the brain is plastic and is moulded in particular by our early relationships with our primary caregivers, and Tanya's neurobiological development has been seriously disturbed by her traumatic experiences, which have been compounded again and again over the years. And we can see that Tanya exhibits many of the vast array of symptoms of complex trauma. So now that I have a curious stance of Tanya through a trauma-informed lens, how can I actually begin to help Tanya? My assessment tells me that Tanya's in crisis at the moment. Her internal and external world are in chaos. I'm very concerned about her safety emotionally, physically and socially. But apart from these outward behavioural manifestations of trauma and significant psychosocial stressors, I also wonder about what she's experiencing internally, and I imagine how overwhelmed that she must be feeling. I wonder about some of the triggers, about her daughter wanting to leave home, might be touching on some of her own trauma from around the same time, these awful nightmares and the intolerance for having food in her mouth, which suggests that the sexual abuse she's experienced has involved her mouth in some way, which is leading to a massive interruption of her daily life in terms of not wanting to eat and losing a lot of weight, malnutrition, which is a really serious problem. It's interesting to note that she wants to reconnect with her mother at this time, suggesting a really urgent need for love and attachment and security. So it seems...
Sarah, can I just get you to pop your microphone a bit closer to your mouth? It's just a little hard to hear you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's close as I can get it without eating it. How's that?
Yeah, that's fine. And just speak up. That's good. Thank you.
I'm going to speak up a little bit?
Yes, please.
Okay. So it seems that Tanya is being overwhelmed by the stress and terror of her past unresolved traumas, which are seriously intruding into her life now as an adult, as she hasn't yet developed the skills of self-care, which we acquire by relationships. So it would be really important to not rush Tanya into processing the details of her trauma with me until she's safe and has the capacity for self-regulation and self-care. It's possible that we might remain in that early phase of treatment, which is focused on safety, for a really long time without moving on to processing or anything. Just working in a safe and trusting manner will be a good start. So there's obviously lots of issues to address, and Tanya's story could possibly be a little bit overwhelming, so it'll also be important to monitor my own reactions to Tanya and to attend clinical supervision. So I'm really glad that was in the case study. But the first priority is to promote her sense of safety. At this point, I'd like to acknowledge the ASCA guidelines and the principles of trauma-informed care that are outlined in there. I found the guidelines to be really helpful in terms of my own daily practice. And let me just move along the slide. So the trauma-informed principles are safety, trust, choice, collaboration, and empowerment. And to my mind, these are the things that are taken away from children who experience abuse. And it's a primary therapeutic task to try and reinstate these features in my interactions, my therapeutic relationship with Tanya. So safety is number one. Safety and not causing further harm and trauma are essential ideas for me to be holding in my mind. Working with Tanya, because unfortunately, I know that mental health professionals and mental health services can inadvertently re-traumatise survivors. So if I do no harm, that's a good start. Some more examples of promoting a sense of safety with Tanya in this case would be to help her feel calm and safe by being calm myself and having consistent boundaries. So her earlier question inviting me to have sex with her is an opportunity to instill a sense of safety with Tanya. I view this invitation of hers as a very disturbing reflection of just how deeply her boundaries have been violated and smashed by caregivers, so-called caregivers, and how sex is possibly a confusing and unsafe form of her seeking attachment with others.
Mm-hmm.
I would be very focused on taking all of Tanya's complaints very seriously and all of her concerns seriously, being very careful not to dismiss her in any way. I'd be on the lookout for dissociation, and from the description in the case study of her change in tone and affect, I think that's possibly what might be happening for her sometimes. So I'd be using grounding techniques, making comments which reassure her that she's safe with me, that what happened to her was not her fault, and I'd be working with a knowledge of neurobiology in mind and being cautious not to over or work within that window of tolerance. I'd be wanting to try to gain Tanya's trust slowly over time. This is vital for her to begin to perhaps start to work with me, to start to disclose some more details of her trauma and the related painful emotional states such as shame. I would be wanting Tanya to trust me enough to increase her frequency of visits. She's been coming monthly, and I don't think it's enough. I'd be wanting her to try to come more frequently, weekly at least, and really, without being pushy, letting her know that I'm a source of consistency and support and nurturing that she can really rely upon. I might even also offer phone contact and probably try to, involve other people in her care or other supports. I would think it's really important to let Tanya know that I don't judge her, that I see her very worrying behaviours as her attempts to cope with overwhelming pain, fear and stress, and as her way of trying to put the pieces back together somehow. I would be offering Tanya psychoeducation about trauma symptoms and painting the landscape for her about what what she can expect and reassure her that her reactions are normal responses to overwhelming stress, and maybe give her a little bit of information about neuroplasticity, the social brain, and healing. It's essential to offer her hope that recovery is possible at any stage with the right kind of help. And I would, explore with Tanya her personal meaning of the connections between her pain, her drinking, her self-harm, her suicidality, try to get her meaning with those things. I would anticipate ongoing fluctuations with her affect and her attendance, her engagement, and this will just be a normal part of the very slow healing process. I would be focusing on trying to foster her affect regulation and self-soothing distress tolerance, holding in mind that healing relationships, more than anything, more than any particular technique, is the healing factor, and trying to help Tanya integrate her emotional functioning, cognitive functioning, her physical health. But again, slowly over time, very holistically. I'm probably running out of time, but I just, is that my last slide? Yes, it is. I just wanted to quickly, is that okay, Mary? Have I got another minute or so?
Yep, you've got, okay. Yes, this is your last slide.
Yeah, this is my last slide. So complex trauma, as we know, is often misdiagnosed and mistreated, resulting in fragmented care over time that can inadvertently re-traumatise someone like Tanya. So it would be great if there was a stable person in her life who could coordinate her care, that can form a stable base if more people become involved in her care. There's some really practical concerns apart from the psychotherapeutic needs that I'd like to quickly address. And for me, one of the red flags is child safety. I'm pretty worried about the safety of her daughters at this point and the fact that she might need some help with parenting, and we might need to have some very transparent and honest discussions about particularly the risk of her younger daughter, who's 9 years old, who by the sounds of it is being left alone at night sometimes, or Tanya's bringing herself and intoxicated partners home with her young 9-year-old in the house. And I'd just be talking to Tanya about risks that she's putting her children in, and also her eldest daughter, who's probably undergoing some emotional and psychological harm from witnessing her deliberate self-harm. I'd be telling Tanya that I'm a mandatory reporter in my professional role, and letting her know about when I'll be obligated to report, but framing that in a supportive way and trying to help her take care and take responsibility and accept some help with parenting. The other red flag is suicide, and I take Tanya's suicidality very seriously. I'd be conducting a thorough suicide risk assessment. And while I know that the ongoing safety and security of a long-term therapeutic relationship and other healing social relationships are going to be the long-term buffers against suicide, that sometimes she might be in imminent risk and, might need to put more supports in place, daily contacts, and put together a really good plan. I'd really try to avoid calling acute care services and admissions, but that might be a possibility at some point with Tanya. Work with Tanya's strengths, work with her goals. She's identified a couple of them. She's made a new friend. She wants to keep parenting her daughters. She wants to keep her job. The only other thing is sort of potential referrals to maybe her GP. Does she need a work certificate to cut back to part-time work for a little while? Her job is at risk. Her finances are going to become a problem. And her physical health, there's a few other things. I'll leave it there for now, Mary.
Okay, thanks, Sarah. And I know that a number of the themes that you've raised there around the suicidality, the child safety issues, there's been lots of themes coming up about boundaries, and so we will revisit those in the discussions all together. And thanks very much, Sarah, for your contribution. And Philip, I can see that your first slide's up there, and I'd welcome your response to Tanya. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Thanks for the invitation to talk about such an important topic as complex trauma from, relational psychotherapeutic perspective. Psychology, in the main, sort of tends towards exposure therapy for trauma. And when we enter the realm of complex trauma, we sort of have to go very easy on exposure. So my first slide really talks about dissociation, avoidance, or flight. And from my perspective, with complex trauma, we need to make friends with avoidance behavior, and actually probably even need to support it, at least be mindful of it and not fight with it in terms of needing to expose people, but actually support people more mindfully in their dissociative or avoidance behaviors in a therapeutic way. So some of that is just to normalize fight or flight. You know, our body, our nervous system has these capabilities, and fight or moving away from stuff that's overwhelming is good. It's healthy. And by inference, hey, good on you for taking care of yourself in whatever way you're finding yourself needing to cope currently. So to normalize that is very, very powerful and good in working with people. Tanya shows a lot of flight impulses, her eating, her alcohol, her potential dependency on Ramona is another one, her blackouts, her self-harming or suicide behavior, her dreams of mummy taking all the pain away. All of that I see as indications of a flight response. And so all of that I'm going to make friends with, not necessarily delve into too deeply, but just make friends with it. I may do small exercises with her in the room, such as, well, you've told me so much about the stresses of your life. You look a little overwhelmed by it all at the moment. I'm wondering if we can do an exercise for a moment and see if she's interested in that, and say something like, you know, we can do a small exercise where, how about for a moment we just leave all that stress in that chair that you're sitting in, and maybe invite you to come over and sit in this other chair, because I have two chairs in my room. And I say, this other chair, we'll just by magic, we'll call it the stress-free chair. And I just wonder if for a moment or two, if you just have a little bit of time out in the stress-free chair. I mean, we can come back to all that stuff in a second, but you just look overwhelmed at the moment. So what I'm doing in therapy now is just doing a flight response therapeutically. I'm not having her do anything else except move from stress to being stress-free, and that's what she's doing with all her symptomatic behavior. Her blackouts and parts of self, her blackouts are also needing to be some psychoeducation, as Sarah was saying, some normalization, some relational connection. So blackouts, I would just normalize them and say, hey, anyone can have blackout if they drink too much. So, then to talk a little bit about parts of self, the mind in someone who's a complex trauma survivor is quite often quite fragmented, and a person could be hearing voices. And I want to make friends with those parts of self and indeed suggest that we take care of the many different parts of self and look after ourselves in that way. I also want to talk about attachment and normalize attachment and her secure attachment experiences that didn't get to happen, and that she shows a lot of attachment needs, and to help her understand that it's normal again. It's physiologically normal for us human beings to want attachment and crave attachment. And so that reference to, you know, do you want to have sex with me in the vignette, as Sarah was saying, I would tie that into her attachment needs and normalize that, and at the same time as setting a clear boundary about the therapeutic relationship. So I would say to her something like, Tanya, your attachment needs are normal and healthy. I know that you don't want to have them with some people, because they're not to be had with some people, but with yourself and the right people, you know, attachment's great. And then that leads me into, hey, let's explore that a little bit. So maybe just take a moment to connect with yourself or attach with yourself right now and just notice what that's like. And so, again, take the theme into the present moment of doing some therapy with her. The core relationship always has to be, I have a very strong bias here, always with the client, with themselves. So I do hear what Sarah was saying about, you know, to develop good relationship with the therapist, but my bias even more is to help the client really have a better relationship with themselves than with me. I want them to really hang out with themselves and start to make friends with themselves, to be self-understanding, self-regulating, self-caring, self-accepting. So I really want the client to ultimately take over the parenting that they missed out on. Now, that takes some work, but that's the direction that I'd be heading with Tanya. And finally, clear boundaries and limits. No matter what has happened to a client, they still need to be appropriate as an adult. And so I will be gently, or not too gently sometimes, saying to people, you know, I know you've been really traumatized and so on, but, you know, you can't treat your children, you can't treat yourself, you can't treat your parents, you can't treat society in any antisocial sort of way. So I'm glad that you've come to talk to me, because it's showing me that you want to change that, and we can transform that into good relationships. So clear therapeutic boundaries and limits are absolutely part of the picture as well. Thanks, Mary.
Thanks very much, Philip. And I know that what you were saying before about the person's relationship with themselves and their inner parenting and in a capacity to care for themselves is a little bit along what Bradley was going to talk about that we made him skim over. So thank you for that. Now, I would like to welcome Warwick to just give his response also to Tanya before we start the discussion between the different disciplines. Welcome,
yeah, thanks,
Warwick.
Mary. Tanya is a complex, challenging individual, and unfortunately, because in our world, all of the issues she has are actually quite common, and that's the challenge, is that, you know, this sort of trauma has largely been silenced by fear and shame. And well, I guess one of the things that I would emphasize in dealing with someone like Tanya is just how important an acknowledgement of the shame and fear that actually underlies the secrecy of abuse really is. I think one of the things that underlies all the therapeutic approaches is something we could call acceptance. And that's part of the building of a sound therapeutic alliance. And with a sound therapeutic alliance, a great deal is possible. Without it, virtually nothing is possible. One of the things we're picking up about Tanya is that she has had very limited development of selfhood. So if you grow up in an environment where there are no boundaries, it's very, very hard to actually have sound boundaries, because you learn boundaries by being brought up in environments that have them. There's challenging things for the therapist in this, that she throws up issues about self-harm, which for some can be disturbing. She throws up issues about sexual boundaries, which for some can be frightening. And she throws up references to things that are difficult for some people to get their head around in terms of the sort of traumas that actually have happened to her. Someone made a question I noticed earlier about... let me just think what it was. It was about... you know, the issue of whether, you know, it's possible to or desirable to sort of insist that people such as Tanya, you know, don't self-harm if they come into therapy. In fact, it's incredibly unhelpful, because all you're doing is really setting up something that's unworkable, because the vast majority of people that come from this spectrum, self-harm's been a part of their life and a part of their coping style since almost forever. And what therapy is about is ultimately, bit by bit, replacing, you know, usable but fairly maladaptive forms of self-soothing with more adaptive. And that means, you know, utilizing skills, developing relationships. But somewhere I also say, you know, don't give up your day job. You know, there's things that she's got that are strengths. She has been a mother. She has worked in the workforce. She is capable of having friends. So these are important things. But also remember that you know, that the average age at which, you know, someone gets sexually abused, the commonest age where it starts is something about the age of 3. So a 3-year-old is very conditioned sexually, and that brings with it the manipulation of the abuser. about the utilization of the of manipulation of arousal, the in, often at times the induction of altered ego states or dissociative states that actually are used by the abuser to enact their sexual abuse processes. Look, can I, you know, people, you know, talk about, you know, processing trauma. Some people, you know, leap in a bit far too quickly, really, and you know, it all sort of goes pie-shaped. I mean, what you're really trying to do is establish a safe avenue, and in order to do that, you know, one doesn't, you know, one looks at how much petrol you've got in the tank. You don't set out on a journey where you haven't got enough petrol to make the journey. It's been mentioned earlier tonight that, you know, is one therapy session a month adequate? And almost certainly it's very, very suboptimal, and sometimes that can bring more problems than it solves. Some people that have been so traumatised and have, you know, so little ego strength and so little supports that they really have got very, they're a walking wounded casualty station sort of victim, and you know, you're not going to get them, you know, charging out onto the battlefield again without a lot of time spent initially getting to a point of basic safety. And always remember that, you know, these people have been brought up in environments where very few people were to be trusted, and safety was something that they experienced very infrequently and sometimes never experienced. So at the other hand, on the other side of the coin, it doesn't help to essentially say to the patient that, you know, because you've had such a terrible life, you know, it's excusable for you to do anything, and we'll excuse it on the basis that you've been so abused that you don't have to be responsible. You know, you've ultimately, you know, life is very unfair, and ultimately you've got to play the hand you've been dealt. And you know, one of the corollaries of that is that at the end of the day, the majority of the work that has to be done ultimately has to be done by the patient. If you're in therapy and you're not being challenged and you're not feeling some discomfort about some of the things you're dealing with, then you're probably riding along pretty well, but nothing much is changing. And as I said earlier, you know, don't insist on pledges, you know, that not to self-harm. And don't in any way assume that in order to have therapy that you've got to have total trust from the patient. I mean, many of these patients' transferences are based on what you might call mistrust or indeed paranoia, but that doesn't mean that they won't turn up. But they're checking you out, and the checking out may go on for a long, long time. On the other hand, some people in this spectrum do develop trust, and when they do, it's a pretty solid component of an ongoing positive therapeutic alliance. But don't insist on it. And I always say, you know, I wouldn't, if I was in your position, I wouldn't trust anyone either. So, you know, and we dispense with the issue with that, and it doesn't usually become an issue. Could I just say that, you know, therapy is not a manual. You know, there are a lot of guidelines and principles, a lot of which have been enumerated by people here already tonight, but it's very unhelpful to get a manual that says, you know, by week 10, you know, you should be processing this, or you should be at this stage or that stage. When people do that sort of thing, it invariably ends up badly. What you do is adhere to general principles, but people are different enough that no, you know, regimented, prescribed process that seemingly works with one will generally can be applied unchanged to another person. People have different trajectories. Some have got a lot more social support. Some have got a lot of skills. Some in fact are still in situations where they're being exposed to ongoing abuse, and it stands to reason that you can't do anything about processing past trauma when you're still actually having the same sort of trauma being reenacted in your life. And one of the studies that I've been involved in is the issue of ongoing incestuous abuse during adulthood. And when you deal with the people at the severe end of the complex trauma system, those that have diagnosis of dissociative identity disorder, one finds that a significant proportion, I would say probably in the region of about 1 in 8 of those, have experienced or continue to experience ongoing incestuous abuse as adults. And some therapists are completely unaware that the reason that their patient is not getting well or is periodically getting badly decompensated is because they're still being abused. And in a dissociated state, this is not being enumerated or recognised. And of course, one of the things that comes up in this case is there are a lot of references to things that sound highly dissociative, you know, changes in mood states, patchy or absent memory of, you know, sexual encounters with people, and turning up in a very sexualized sort of seemingly state, you know, offering sexual contact with a therapist. Can I just leave you with just a couple of reference points for further reading? One is with the ASCA guidelines are absolutely very, very helpful, and I guess a more specialized look at guidelines as they pertain to severe dissociation is the International Society for the Study of Trauma and Dissociation guidelines for the treatment of dissociative identity disorder. And it's indicative of the fact that this is very mainstream psychiatry in Australia. Last month's edition of the Australian and New Zealand Journal of Psychiatry had an extensive review, which is available from the website, or if anyone wants to contact me, I'll send them a copy. So thank you, Mary.
Thanks very much, Warwick. Now, what we're going to progress to now is the discussion between how we work together as professionals to care for someone like Tanya. Now, Bradley, something that came up in the participant chat box, there's been a lot of conversation about going slow and being respectful of people's, traumatized state and not pushing them into talking about things. And this may seem in a way in contrast with your encouragement to not be scared of opening the can of worms. So I wondered if you could just comment a little bit more about how we open cans of worms in a slow and respectful way that doesn't harm people further.
Well, I think in Tanya's situation, the can of worms is already open. There's no kind of risk in regard to kind of like or fear to say, well, I don't want to open a can of worms with people, because most trauma survivors, in my experience, are coming with that can of worms open. Tanya is kind of operating in ways that kind of like show up that she's really struggling. So it's not about going slowly for the sake of not trying to open the can of worms. It's going slowly in order to be able to honour that it may take time for the a trusting relationship to be built, and that in the therapeutic relationship, that trust is everything from my perspective, around people being able to kind of like regulate themselves to the point of being able to make meaning around the good things that can come out of a therapeutic alliance. That's where my approach to slowing down comes into it, and the trust that's developed in the relational realm can support the articulation in a safe way of the ways in which Tanya is coping.
And Bradley, I understand that you also, we didn't get time for the Vygotsky quote, but really what it's talking about is that every function in the child's development appears twice, so on the social level and then later on the individual level. So in a way, someone else also spoke, I think it was Philip, about developing our own internal parent, and the therapist can sometimes form that function in loco parentis, which I know was an issue you wanted to raise. So I wondered if you just wanted to kind of address that to Sarah, and we'll have how you would work together around that.
Sure. My perspective is that there are, and I have this discussion often and often around people working with people with mental illness as well, is that what elements of friendship actually exist in the worker-client relationship, and what elements of being in loco parentis with a person is actually to the greater good and is supportive of the person feeling that they're well supported in an environment where they may never have had that actually occur in their life in the past, or that's been undone through trauma. So I would like to hear from others around they think about that issue.
Sarah, I might just open that up to you. As a therapist, you know, what's that experience like of becoming aware that you are in a way helping reparent someone, and how do you manage that in yourself as a therapist?
Yeah, well, I'd just like to point out that I'm not a psychotherapist. I think I'm probably the only person on the panel that isn't trained in psychotherapy, but I work in long-term therapeutic relationships with highly complex, poorly engaged, ambivalent people with multiple complex needs, the vast majority of whom have backgrounds of horrible abuse and have developed complex trauma. So I work in a therapeutic way long term, but I'm not a therapist, so I'll just say that. But yeah, I definitely know that feeling and recognize that dynamic of working with adults of all ages, and I'm being parentalized, and I think it's absolutely fine because I will have my professional boundaries, and I think it's very therapeutic to be attuning and using my skills to soothe and calm, listen, validate, attend to the needs of the consumers that I'm working with, to promote a sense of safety and security. And I'm very aware a lot of the time that I've worked with people that are very similar to Tanya who have been abused in their family times, then moved on to institutions, who've then been abused in those institutions, who've then wound up on the street, had children early, no time for self-healing, developing a sense of self or anything like that, and then seeing this suite of very creative but ultimately harmful ways of trying to cope with substances, with self-harm, with you know, unsafe relationships and all of this kind of thing that we see with Tanya. I feel like, without sounding patronizing, it's part of my role to soothe the inner child. Even though I'm an adult and I'm working with an adult and we're not related, I'm not this person's parent, I definitely see some of those elements of parenting as a really important part of the way that I relate with my consumers and make the space between us a safe one, a consistent one. Role modelling, appropriate behaviour, self-care and all of those things. So I'm probably repeating myself now. So, yeah.
And thanks for that, Sarah. And I think it follows on to something Philip did raise about building up the person's capacity to care for themselves in that way as well. So I wondered, Philip, if I could take it over to you. So you had a comment about the importance of early intervention to attend to the presenting crisis issues and calming the nervous system. And I wondered how that goes about. If you could just talk more about how that is also about their capacity to care for themselves and how you practically build that up. So start sure. with that.
Sure. Thanks, Mary. One of the bits and pieces that I'm looking for is knowing that I'm progressing with someone. I get a sense of that by just paying attention to how they are in the present moment. And I hear the story, but I'm paying more attention, if you like, to the storyteller. So that orients me to the present moment and the person's present experience. And the legacy of the complex trauma, as Reich said to us, you know, is present in every breath and every gesture and every moment of the client's present experience. So I want to get onto any presenting crisis matters and anything that's really threatening the person. I want to identify and then say, hey, there's a service that I know that can help you with that. Hey, I can help you with that issue. Hey, let's do that with that issue. Let me get you this person's details and contacts to support you with that issue and so on.
And Philip, can I just interrupt you there? Just on a practical level, how do you, if you're aware how distressed this person is, how vulnerable they are, the complexity of what's going on, how do you choose who to refer them to, and how do you then communicate with that other person that they're seeing, whether it's a support service or another therapist, or, how do you build those relationships, and how do you find people that you can trust to do a good job?
Well, I have to trust a lot of professionals that they will do a general good job, but those people that I know, I'll refer to straight away. So if I know a good legal person, I'll be straight on the phone to them. If I know a good financial counsellor for someone, or someone who's good at welfare or social work, I'll jump straight on the phone or straight on the internet, or speak highly to the client of these resources and try and get that the crisis matters taken care of as quickly as possible. Now, I know we've talked about trust. Trust is sometimes built in that Rogerian way, where you just empathise with the client's feelings and so on. And trust, I believe, is also built through very pragmatic crisis intervention. If you do something or offer something or suggest or organise something that's very, very helpful pragmatically, that cements a client to you very, very strongly. So, and what I'll be looking for then is this client sort of giving out a big sigh. Oh, you know, I can see a light at the end of the tunnel. Oh, there is a hope here. There's something good about attending counselling. There's some way forward for me. You know, I don't have to live in misery. There are better options, a better possibility. So trying to look at the nervous system. And I know I'm going well when my clients are relaxing, when they're physically melting, if you like, or those big sighs of relief, or those big sighs of, oh, I didn't know about that. I wasn't aware of that. And, oh, that's a possibility. And I'll say, that's a possibility for you. And they go, oh, that feels so much better. So when the weight's going off their shoulders, then I know there's potential for more cortical, neocortical, or self-awareness. So I get less of the child acting out and more of the adult who can see a way forward. And that's the parental, the inner parent or the inner self, that I want this more grown-up self now to be more present. And I ideally want to do more therapy with the grown-up self than with the children, the inner children. I want the self to talk to the inner children. And so there's an inner parenting that starts off here in this sort of elongated sort of fashion.
Thanks, Philip. And I think that would flow on to a question really for Warwick. I'd like Warwick to answer. That's come right from the general chat. So, Warwick, many of the practitioners in our participant, you know, room tonight, of whom there have been a steady 800 for the last hour, are working in situations where the person only has access to them through Medicare and they're limited to 10 sessions.
Yeah.
So I just wondered if you had any thoughts about whether we should even embark on a 10-session in treatment, or, you know, what to be careful about, because I'm sure you have some thoughts about that.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I inherit at times the refugees from this sort of scenario where someone's embarked on a once-a-month or something like that therapy with somebody who's very dissociative and highly traumatised, and, you know, can't hold it together from, you know, 1 week to the next, let alone for 4 to 5 weeks. And then, you know, it meanders along, and then, of course, they run out of their sessions, and then there's this, what do I do now? And that's probably the entry point that you sort of hear about the problem, which gets back to what I was saying before about, you know, checking how much petrol you got in the tank before you set out on the journey. Generally speaking, if you know, and I mentioned the International Society guidelines on DID, which is that applies to the sort of severe end of this spectrum, and, you know, the general principles there that if you are undertaking effective therapy, then you're probably looking, you know, at reasonably long term therapy that's happening about once to twice a week. I might add, it generally doesn't help on a regular basis to do it more often than that, because the message you're giving then is that, you know, you're telling the patient effectively that they're incapable of sort of managing their life day to day. On the other hand, if you set up a working with somebody who just is, you know, very unsafe, and you know, seeing someone and saying, well, you know, we'll see you in another 5 weeks' time, is often less than helpful, to the point of, you know, it could in some cases actually be harmful, I think, to set up something that you've got no expectation of ever finishing, and where you can never logistically put together a workable therapy. So, but having said that, you know, everyone, as I said before, is different, and while some people get support by seeing someone relatively infrequently, they may not be processing much, but it does provide some support and stability to their lives. Others just become more fragmented by it and end up being referred on somewhere else.
And what about the idea of actually doing your 10 sessions weekly or perhaps fortnightly, but starting to, you know, at the beginning of that, knowing you've got 10 sessions, making sure that the person's got other supports in, and then doing it in bursts, you know, is that ever...
So the reality is then you get to the end of your 10th session in your burst, and then you say, well, over to you now. We'd hope that you'd be cured now, but now you're just actually coming apart. So
we're going to lobby you.
So, you know, if in doubt, don't is generally the principle, you know. It's not a good thing to be experimenting. You know, I've never done this before, and I'll see what happens. And whoops, you know, it turned out pie-shaped, and now can I find somewhere to kind of offload this terribly messed up patient that wasn't helped by therapy, which is often a hard sell as well.
Yeah. Thank you for that. Bradley, I wondered if you wanted to comment on that from the perspective of the consumer themselves, you know, whether a short but supportive, positive experience might be better than nothing, or whether it would be better to wait for the option of the longer-term support.
Look, I really think it does come down to the individual. I think I've often been heard to describe my recovery as accidental, moving from one kind of supportive or situation to another and having short grabs at it. But I think it's the quality, because we don't live in an ideal world. We don't live in a situation where people are going to necessarily be able to engage in that long-term counselling, and I don't think our system's set up for that either. My personal opinion from my own experience is that it can be done in the accidental recovery kind of model. But it's more ideally suited to have some significant opportunities to engage with somebody who can hold that space or support the holding of that space while skills are developed that may not have been developed before. But there is a thing called accidental recovery, and I think there's many, many people out there doing that.
And I think, Bradley, the research says that about 40% of the change that happens during therapy is related to what we call extra therapeutic factors, the things that actually happen in someone's life that are nothing to do with therapy. So I'm sure you're right. And I also just wanted your comment on, you know, if Philip's been very, you know, strong about the fact that people also need to be responsible for behaving well and not to behave in ways that are harming other people, even though they themselves have been traumatised. And one of those things might be the child safety matter, or sometimes... taking mandatory, you know, action if someone's seriously suicidal. But I wonder how, from the consumer point of view, how that can be experienced, or can a therapeutic relationship survive some of those mandatory responsibilities of the professional?
I think sometimes they can. Sometimes they can and sometimes they can't. And my approach to it is that... when a person is using coping strategies that are harmful to themselves, that's one thing, and that those coping strategies are very creative ways of dealing with dysregulation. And yet, if there's imminent threat of harm to themselves or others, I think a duty of care kind of arrangement swings in there in support of the person staying on the planet. And also in relation to children, if there's imminent threat of harm. And yet, sometimes that gets over-exaggerated in that a person is it's not an imminent threat to harm, and the person is, on the one hand, they're in the rooms with the person seeking to make a difference in their lives, and they haven't yet developed the skills and this is taking away homicide, suicide as a part of that equation. But in Tanya's situation, the self-harming scenario, it's so easy to conflate self-harm with suicide. And I think that's a mistake, and they need to be kind of like unpacked side by side. Because for Tanya, the self-harming process may actually be a stress-relieving activity that she's creatively adapted in order to be able to manage her internal pain. So I think we can't kind of be very black and white about that, but we do have to stay close to what is our duty of care when it comes to that imminent serious harm to self or others. So I think it's a maturing conversation around what's the agency in the, you know, we need to be able to consult people around their agency in regard to how they're managing their own self-regulation. And that without kind of going, well, you can't do that anymore, even though that may be the only coping strategy you have, without recognising that it has had agency and it's costly. And, okay, once we've acknowledged that, how can we develop some other strategies that might support you better?
Thank you for that. And we're just down to the last few minutes, so I'm going to invite everyone to offer their final comments. But I guess what I'm really thinking about is if we have a team here where we've had a psychiatrist, we might have a mental health nurse in a general practice setting, the patient may have been referred to a psychologist as well, and then the person themselves. So I wonder if you could be thinking about that teamwork together for the recovery of this person in your final comments. So I think I will first invite Sarah to just any final comments you want to leave for people, with particularly about collaboration with other professionals and the person themselves. Thank you.
Thanks, Mary. I think the thing to remember is that the trauma-informed care revolution has just sort of begun, and at the moment we're working in imperfect systems, and the services are kind of split up, but we should aim for integration and safety and working together holistically and just holding those principles in our mind. Just that we, you know, there is a national and an international movement that's happening regarding trauma-informed care. At the moment it's important for us to maintain connections to our networks, our collegial networks, keep increasing our knowledge base and working in a very person-centered way. I think multidisciplinary collaboration is essential, and
thank you. And I think I'd like to invite Warwick next, and I noticed your comment, Warwick, that you often end up seeing the refugees from the system where the system's failed them. So I wondered if you had any kind of final comments about how we can work well together to try to avoid the refugees happening.
So many of these people in this spectrum have had, you know, past experiences where they were made to feel awful, or where effectively they were trying to communicate in a system that spoke another language. In fact, it was only like 2 hours ago that a patient said to me, you know, look, it's just, and I think the exact quote, and I just wrote it down, because literally it was 2 hours ago. She said, the best feeling is having someone that speaks my language. And, you know, you get this discordance between people speaking in different tongues where somebody's trauma and dissociation is interpreted as being bad behaviour and manipulation or attention-seeking, or that people think that you know, people get some sort of joy out of, you know, inserting objects into themselves or cutting themselves or burning themselves, you know, to the point that they are a recipient of disparaging remarks or treated in such a way that they're clearly unwanted. And you know, for somebody, I emphasise the issue of shame, and you're talking about collaborative approaches. You know, if the entire system did nothing else but actually treated people in such a way that didn't induce shame, and showed a modicum of empathic connection. You know, some of the things that escalate into crises, you know, just wouldn't happen. I would just make a comment about, there was one part in the vignette that emphasises this, you know, how an awareness of attachment dynamics and the processes of shame makes an awful big difference. We heard in the vignette that Tanya made some sort of sexual invitation to the therapist. Now, for people who have worked a long time in the field, it's not that uncommon that in some form or other you're going to encounter people who make some sort of sexual invitation. And yet there are multiple levels of meaning in that. And for some, it's literally a reality that's the currency of relatedness in all the environments they ever lived in. So that's the only way they know to relate. So it's going to come up in therapy. It's come up in every single other relationship. For others, it's a way of actually, paradoxically, of testing safety. That sort of question arises at a time when they've actually deduced. We talked about, you know, mistrust before, when they actually paradoxically have mistrust you less to the point that they make that invitation so that they can be then satisfied that it's safe. And when that sort of awareness that makes a lot of difference. You know, so other people could just say, you know, make some disparaging remark about their, you know, sexual boundaries and they just feel go away silently and feel terrible yet again. And I mentioned before those for which abuse is ongoing, that the amount of shame that they carry is enormous. So these are the people that have, their bodies are racked with self-harm and their internal bodies often carry the scars of stuff that was done to them. So,
thanks so much, Warwick. You know, your wisdom's really invaluable. And I know that was a theme that the participants were picking up as well. So thank you very much for that. Now, Bradley, I just wondered if you had any final comments about how we can work together.
Look, I think interdisciplinary practice is the way forward. Mental health, nursing, psychology, psychiatry. But what I would like to see embedded in that mix is peer workforce. I know from previous experience of working in the acute sector around seclusion and restraint reduction that it was actually hearing the stories from peers that actually enabled, in a kind of hard struggle kind of a way, for people to be able to come to a multi-voiced understanding and strategies that actually fell out the other end of that multi-voiced understanding that worked for everybody by including the people who had the lived experience themselves in that mix, going, when you say that, this is how I experience it. And psychiatry saying, I don't know quite how to do that differently for you, but let's have an ongoing conversation about that. I think that's the interdisciplinary practice that has the best future, is one that involves all of the stakeholders and, in particular, a peer workforce, a lived experience workforce that can support that often unheard voice in that situation.
Thanks so much, Bradley. And I should acknowledge we have the social workers, occupational therapists, counsellors, students in the audience. So it's really, really valuable to hear that. Thanks so much. And Philip, I'd just like to invite you to offer a final comment, particularly about how we work together. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks, Mary. I think sometimes some psychoeducation is needed about different professionals and different approaches. I mean, I don't want to pick on anyone, but the medical fraternity really has a bit of a model of making symptoms go down. And I think psychologically and psychotherapeutic fraternity has more, let's have that, let's notice that, let's see what that's saying. What's the message being conveyed there? So we can appear to be working at odds with each other. And I think to educate our clients, you know, that, you know, this is just the way other medical people may work with you. They may want things to go down, and there's nothing wrong with that. But, you know, if you're going to come and work with me, we need to contain some things and make some things go away or go down. But there's also a dialogical model or a relational model. Let's hear it. Let's see what it's about. Let's engage with it. And So I don't want to make other allied professionals or other professionals wrong. I just say there's different ways of working and try and educate my client around that. And then generally be very very forthright about referring clients and very happy to refer. Moreover, in the end, I'm hoping to really let my clients know that I have a very positive outlook for them. I think they've got more strength, more resilience, more abilities, more attributes, more skill, more beauty, more potential than what maybe they're aware of. And I'm going to try as early as I can to help them get that. I see them as more than their limitations, more than their pathology, so to speak. So there's more beauty in them than that. So I want my clients to get that as soon as they can, that I see there's more to them than their pathologies as well. So, and keep supporting them in their growth into holism, if you like, be a full human being.
Thank you so much, Philip. I think that's a really hopeful note to end on, and it certainly is the message of understanding things in a trauma-informed way, is that recovery is possible and that these are understandable responses to things that have happened.
Yeah.
So thanks so much to the whole panel and to the participants. I'm aware that we have gone over time, but I just decided that it was,
it was
important to do that. So I just encourage everybody to complete the exit survey. You will be sent a link to online resources within the next couple of days. The next MHPN webinar is not in this series, but it will be equally interesting and valuable, which is around mental health, parenting and recovery, and it's an interdisciplinary discussion as well. That will be on Thursday the 26th of June. Remember that this was part of a series of three. The other two webinars are available to download and watch. And the first one was particularly aimed at general practitioners. So if any of you are dealing with GPs that you think would benefit from learning this and might take the time to watch it, please send them the link. And so once again, thank you very much to everybody. And we'll see you all again at another MHPN webinar. And don't forget the main website to go and have a look for what's available in your area. Thanks so much for participating and for staying the extra 10 minutes. Good night, everybody.
Thank you, Mary.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.